of the United States. Brian Mulroney was the Prime Minister of Canada. Like Bush's predecessor, Ronald Reagan, Mulroney became fast friends with the president.
The mark of a good relationship is that the leaders respect each other, they trust each other, and they actually look to each other for advice. Although much has been made of the Mulroney-Reagan relationship, in some ways I think the more important relationship was between Mulroney and George Bush Sr., who succeeded Reagan as president, because there was a President Bush had an enormous healthy respect for the Canadian Prime Minister, and he respected his judgment. He turned to him for advice. There's the famous story that's told that prior to Bush's decision to send U.S. forces to oust Iraqi troops from Kuwait in what we now refer to as the first Gulf War. He first called Margaret Thatcher and said, how should I deal with this? Should I go to the United Nations and get their approval? And how should I deal with the French, French President François Mitterrand, who may not like this idea? And the French, of course, were also permanent members of the Security Council. And Margaret Thatcher's advice was, you just go ahead and do it. We'll support you and damn the Security Council. It just so happened that Bush had invited the Canadian Prime Minister and his wife down to the Maine compound. He had a summer house in Maine. He ran this by Mulroney. And Mulroney said, that's a terrible idea. You should pick up the phone. You should call Mitterrand. I can help you with that, you know, to sort of pave the way. And you should also get the approval of the Security Council, because if you don't, the international community will be against you. And it's not in America's interest to be essentially snubbing the world community in undertaking to invade a country, albeit to restore its territorial integrity. And Bush accepted that advice and did so, I think, very much to the American advantage and the national interest. And I think that's only one illustration of the kind of relationship those two leaders had. And it's interesting, if you look at the Bush-Scowcroft memoirs, these are a series of memoirs he wrote with his national security advisor, Brent Scowcroft. In the index, there are more references to Brian Mulroney than there are to any other national leader. And I think that's symptomatic or illustrative of what was clearly a relationship of great mutual respect.
On October 25th, 1993, it was a liberal landslide. Tory blue was almost erased from the Canadian political landscape. The party went from 157 seats to just two. Voters chose Jean Chrétien as their new leader. Throughout the 1993 election campaign, he made it clear he was not going to follow Mulroney's lead and be close friends with the President of the United States. Yet he enjoyed what some called a chummy relationship with Bill Clinton. He confessed, "When we're alone," said Chrétien, "I call him Bill."
I also want to thank Canada again for what I think is very probably the most cooperative relationship in the world in trade and investment and the work we do in the environment and law enforcement. And I hope that as we look ahead to the new century, that the partnership that we've had, the cooperation we've had, will be a genuine model that other countries will try to follow.
Chrétien told an aide, he's an old pro when talking about Clinton, and he sees me as an even older pro. But this warm relationship would soon change. Next on Bound by a Border, the Bush-Chrétien years.
president and the prime minister don't solve problems, but they set a tone, a direction, which helps officials further down solve problems. The tension really developed between Krychek and Bush. The chemistry just wasn't there. And with the chemistry not there, that infected the relationship as a whole. It meant that people further down the food chain did not answer phone calls to the extent that they normally would have, were not prepared to sit down and solve problems. And so as a result of that, that created a chill throughout the relationship.
One thing I would say is that the adversarial character of that relationship has often been greatly exaggerated. Did these two people enjoy each other's company? I really don't know. I think Chrétien understood that he had to have sort of a good working relationship with the Americans. What went sour there was that the Americans understood, and certainly the American president understood, that Canada was not going to send troops into Iraq. But the request of the American president was, please don't say that too loudly. Chrétien, for whatever reason, some 12 hours after the invasion was announced, went onto the floor of the House of Commons and made a very impassioned speech as to why Canada was not going to participate. And that, and the way he said it, really rankled the Americans. And I think that was sort of a turning point.
Well, it's certainly not surprising that Canadian attitudes towards the United States were negative at that time. This was not isolated to Canada. It was a global phenomenon. If there were public opinion polls done around the world about Bush, and he was almost universally disliked. So Canada is not alone in this situation. But I think Canadians had real concerns about Bush's policies around the war in Iraq, around Guantanamo, treatment of Maher Arar, all kinds of specific human rights and issues related to the United States' role in the world. And Canadians were also concerned about the types of border control policies that were adopted as part of Bush's war on terror. The assumption that terrorists were flowing over the Canada-U.S. border into the United States, which were completely wrong, but resulted in a series of measures being adopted by the United States that really hurt Canadian industry, Canadian trade with the United States, and stopped that long-standing kind of smooth flow of travel across the border in our belief in this longest undefended border in the world.
News of the deep freeze between Bush and Chrétien spread across the world. In the United Kingdom, one reporter for The Guardian wrote, "Every country in the world is screwed up about its relationship with the U.S. But in Canada, it is a national obsession, even a neurosis."
I think that the difficulties between Mr. Chrétien and Mr. Bush eroded the confidence that Americans had in Canada as a partner. And I think that's the most critical thing that we need to do, is to restore that sense of partnership, which was there during the King Roosevelt years. It was there between Kennedy and Pearson. It was there between Mulroney and Reagan. And I think it needs to be there again between Mr. Obama and Mr. Harper.
Then the Paul Martin government opposed George W. Bush's wish for Canada to join him in the missile defense program. And so this further aggravated the relationship.
In the spring of 2004, Maclean's magazine conducted a poll probing what Canadian and Americans really think of each other. They reported, "This new sense of animus is disproportionately centered north of the border." Jonathan Gatehouse wrote, "Things between our countries are apparently getting worse all the time. And the evidence suggests the attitude is almost entirely our own."
We are, always aware of everything that's going on in the United States. And the United States is almost never aware of what's going on in Canada. And that's not unnatural for a large country living next door to a big country. For a small country living next door to a big country, that's fairly natural. But there are issues in which we want to get their attention. There are issues that have to deal with security. There are issues that have to do with trade. There are issues that have to do with the management of the border. There are issues that have to do with the differences in regulations between our two countries. So I think one of the most important things that I would like to see come of Mr. Obama's visit here I would like to see Mr. Harper and Mr. Obama develop some personal chemistry. I think that that should be job one at that particular meeting. Develop the chemistry which will be used in the future to look at certain problems and see how they can be solved.
The global economy has and will continue to dominate the headlines.
It's going to be very important for our leader and the American president to very quickly develop a good working relationship. It doesn't necessarily have to be close, but if it's informed by respect, if it's informed by collegiality, if it's one where both sides feel comfortable picking up the phone, that will be enormously helpful, because I think we're going to be in for a rough ride.
The challenges right now are enormous. I think we have to work with the U.S. administration to pursue policies while not jointly determined. They have to work together.
There's obviously widespread enthusiasm about the Obama administration in Canada. Not surprisingly, he's charismatic, he's different, he's offering change and renewal.
The traditional Canadian friendship and admiration for the United States can be reset in this period, and likely will be.
What's really quite surprising when you look at 100 years of a relationship is that for the most part it's been a pretty damn good one. Sure, there have been hiccups. Sure, there have been points where we've been on a different course. But when you look at the relationship in total, it's hard not to come to the conclusion that it has been one of cooperation, one that has been seen as mutually beneficial.